words. Mistakes. Have you made any of them lately? Well, if you are still on the top side of the earth, I'll guarantee you that you have made some. You know, we make mistakes daily, don't we? And you know, sometimes we make mistakes, and I think that those mistakes can be justified. You know, maybe we are tired, we're worn out, kind of a little brain dead, and you know, we're called upon to make decisions and we're not thinking clearly, and so we make a mistake. But those are not the kinds of mistakes that I'm really concerned about, because most of the mistakes that we make are mistakes that could have been avoided. We violate a principle or a precept that we find in the Word of God, and we make a mistake. I really am concerned today that I think that we are living in a culture that just does not take seriously the ramifications of the mistakes that we make. And we just do not think seriously about the consequences of those mistakes. And sometimes I think that if the church is not careful, that the church can contribute to that cultural thought of not taking mistakes seriously. You know, if I were to ask you today, how would you describe the environment of our church? I think that you would be able to describe it accurately. I've worked for the last 13 years to try to build this environment, and our church is a culture of grace. And that's a good thing. That's the way it ought to be. You know, we live to tell people that we have a God who can deal with your failures of the past. But do you realize that as we do that, we must also be balanced in our message? I was reading a mail out from a local church here in town a while back that came to my home residence, and in that mail out, they made a big deal out of that they were a church that did not have any perfect people. And they were saying that, you know, come to our church because our church is not perfect. Now, while that may be true, we should never rejoice over our imperfections. We should never take them lightly. We should never just blow off the idea of making a mistake. We ought to think seriously about mistakes, because mistakes have serious consequences. Some of them can even be deadly, and we ought to be learning from our mistakes so that we would commit fewer in the future. You know, not only ought we to learn from our mistakes, but we ought to learn from the mistakes of others. I was talking one time with a father in Gulfport, Mississippi, and he had two adult children, two boys. And one of those boys turned out to be a real reprobate. I mean, just one heartache after another, he brought to that family. And the younger child was a child that was the very epitome of a child that honors their parents. And I asked him what the difference was. And he said to me, he said, "Pastor, the younger of my sons learned from the mistakes of the older, and he vowed that he was not going to do the same thing that his older sibling had done." Learning from mistakes. Now, today I want to continue the study of the life of David, and I want to talk to us about that, learning from mistakes. And I want you to open your Bibles to the book of 2 Samuel, chapter number 5. 2 Samuel, chapter 5, and we'll begin reading at verse number 11. 2 Samuel, chapter 5, verse number 11. In verse 11, the Bible says, "And Hiram, the king of Tyre, sent messengers to David, and cedar trees, and carpenters, and masons, and they built David an house. And David perceived that the Lord had established him king over Israel, and that he had exalted his kingdom for his people Israel's sake. And David took him more concubines and wives out of Jerusalem, after he was come from Hebron, and there were yet sons and daughters born to David. And these be the names of those that were born unto him in Jerusalem: Shemua, and Shobab, and Nathan, and Solomon, Ibhar also, and Elishua, and Nepheg, and Japhiah, and Elishama, and Eliada, and Eliphelet." Now, how in the world would you like to try to pronounce these names? I really hope that I'm not making a mistake in preaching this sermon this morning. And the reason I say that is because I want to go back in just a few moments to a previous chapter in our study that we have already looked at. And the reason I want to do that is because as I was reading over chapter 3 just a few weeks ago, there was this idea that seemed to just leap off the page. But the more I thought about it, it was like the Lord just wouldn't put it together. But it's a thought that I've not been able to get away from over these past few weeks. And the more I've meditated on it, the more I believe that God really has a word in this thought, because it is a thought that is dealing with some mistakes that David made. And I think that we can learn from these mistakes, and we will not go and do likewise. So there are three lessons I want us to learn from three mistakes that David made. And the first lesson is the lesson of success. We can learn a lesson of a mistake that David made in relationship to his success. Now, I'm not going to go back and read verses 11 and 12 of this chapter, but it just says very simply that at this point in David's life, that he was very successful in his life and in his ministry. But if you go back to chapter 3, verse number 1, I want you to turn back with me there. Chapter 3 and verse number 1, and notice something here. In verse number 1, it says, "Now there was a long war that was between the house of Saul and the house of David." Now underscore this, "But David grew stronger and stronger, and the house of Saul grew weaker and weaker." And I think that when we put all of the ideas together between chapter 3 and chapter number 5, we discover that as David was growing stronger and stronger in his success, he was growing weaker and weaker in his character. And David really made some serious mistakes when he was at Hebron. As a matter of fact, these mistakes would become the very turning point in his life, in his ministry, and his career. And all of these mistakes that he made were mistakes that had something to do with his character. You know, we have heard that big doors swing on small hinges. And sometimes what appears to be a small mistake can have a large and a great consequence. You know, I've heard this saying all of my life, that after someone makes a mistake and maybe there is a failure in someone's life, we hear this saying that, you know, one failure does not define a person. And while that may be true, dear friend, I want you to understand that one failure can undo a lot of good. And one failure can soil a testimony. And one failure can have serious and devastating consequences. But back to David's success in chapter number 5, and especially verses 11 and 12. Now, we learned last week that David now, when he had been anointed, had been set up his headquarters in the city of Jerusalem. And as he set those headquarters up in Jerusalem, he was, for the first time since he had been anointed by Samuel to be the king, experiencing the unlimited, you might say, rule of his reign that God had promised him once he was anointed. And as he was experiencing that, he was experiencing great power and great blessings from God. As a matter of fact, there are very few monarchs that had such prestige and such a power as David did at this time. It's amazing to realize what David had actually accomplished. He had expanded the borders of the nation of Israel from 6,000 square miles to 60,000 square miles. That was a major accomplishment. He had opened up trade routes literally throughout the known world of that day. And as he had opened up these trade routes, great wealth was pouring into the nation of Israel like it had never experienced before. He had done so many amazing things. He had become friends with world leaders. That's why the Bible tells us in verse number 11 that the king of Tyre, Hiram, sent cedar trees and other materials to build a house. And so David at this point was a remarkable man. He was a brilliant strategist, a brilliant planner, a brilliant organizer. He was a brilliant warrior. And friend, that was a lot of clout for anyone to handle, even for a man who was after God's own heart. You realize there aren't many people today that can be trusted with power and success? You know, as the old saying goes, that power corrupts, but absolute power corrupts absolutely. And that is what we are seeing from the life of David at this particular point. And so let us learn a lesson from the success of David. Let me ask you, what is success? I think that our culture would define success as prosperity that results in a time of ease. Prosperity that results in a time of ease. That's how culture would define it. And friend, what we're going to learn today is that success, based on that definition, is prime hunting ground for the devil. You know, there is an enemy out here. He's like a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. And friend, he doesn't look necessarily at those who are going through times of failure. What he does is he looks for those who are going through times of success, because oftentimes there are weaknesses in their lives. Let me ask you this morning, have you reached a point in your life where you just don't have to worry about stuff you used to have to worry about? If so, be worried. Have you reached a place in your life and in your career where you are at the point where, you know, all of your needs and most of your wants are now met? And you know, you no longer have to worry about praying, give us this day our daily bread, because the truth of the matter is, you don't even have to depend upon the Lord anymore to provide for your daily needs, because your career, you've been successful, and that's providing and taking care of your needs. Well, friend, I want to tell you what, if you've reached that point in your life, then you better be on guard. Let me ask you, have you gotten to the point in your life where you would define your marriage as being a successful marriage? You've been married for a long time. Things are going well between you and your spouse. Be careful lest you stop doing the things that God used to make your marriage successful. What I'm trying to tell us this morning is that successful times can be perilous times if we are not careful. And especially during those times of success, if we stop walking as close to God as we did during those times when we were prosperous. I was reading one time a story about this pastor, and he was a well-known pastor, and he was speaking to a group of ministerial students, and he was talking to them about giving them warnings about what could make them fall in their spiritual leadership. And being a pastor, he used four words that all began with the same letter so that it would be easy for them to remember. And he said, be careful about four things: silver, sloth, sex, and self. In other words, be on guard against money, laziness, immorality, and pride. And friend, I would add two other S words to that list: success, and the word that usually follows success, if we're not careful, self-righteousness. Do you realize that one of the ways that the enemy seeks to defeat us is when we are spiritually successful, thinking we have arrived? Man, we're reading our Bibles daily. We're praying. We're having a quiet time. We're reading books written by authors about the Bible. And we have arrived, spiritually speaking. And all of a sudden, a spirit of self-righteousness finds its way into our hearts. And then we look in ways at those that have made mistakes, in ways that we shouldn't. And in reality, we are just as sinful as the person who has had the failure. You see, that is a tool of the enemy. And I want to remind us today that the sin that Jesus Christ condemned above every other sin in the New Testament was self-righteousness. He beat the Pharisees up over and over again. Man, he clubbed them with the Word of God day in and day out because of their self-righteousness. Friend, learn a lesson about success from the life of David. Because when you think that you're on top of the mountain, That's when you are in a position to experience the greatest fall. So a lesson of success. But secondly, a lesson of family. A lesson of family. Now, go back with me to chapter 3, and I'm going to try hard to pronounce some names here. If I mispronounce them, forgive me, and I'll give you a shot at them if you want them. But a lesson on family. In chapter 3 and verse number 2, so here is David in Hebron. He's experiencing great success and power. And verse 2 says, "And unto David were sons born in Hebron. And his firstborn was Amnon of Ahinoam, the Jezreelitess. And his second was Chileab of Abigail, the wife of Nabal, the Carmelite. And the third, Absalom, the son of Maacah, the daughter of Talmai, the king of Geshur. And the fourth, Adonijah, the son of Haggith. The fifth, Shephatiah, the son of Abital. And the sixth, whatever that is. And he was born by Eglah, David's wife. These were born to David in Hebron." Now, friend, don't miss this point. As David was in Hebron, and as he was resting and things were going so well for him, he had six sons. But the only problem is he had six sons by six different wives. Now, friend, the growth of his family was not a blessing to his life, his career, or his ministry. But the growth of his family was a curse to his life, his career, and his ministry. And what we have pointed out here is a major character flaw in the life of King David, the man after God's own heart. And dear friend, there's a reason why the Bible does not cover up the flaws in the characters of the Bible writers and Bible personalities. And it is because God wants us to learn from their mistakes so that we will not go and repeat the same mistake. Now, what we're going to learn as we walk through this in just a moment is that what David was doing, and as his family was growing, the world looked at what David was doing of that day and said, you know what? There is nothing wrong with this. But dear friend, that's not the assessment that really matters. Because when God looked at what David was doing, God said, David, this is wrong. Now, friend, I don't care what kind of a twist we try to put on this, there is nothing good that can be said about what David did while he was in Hebron, and then when he moved on into Jerusalem and continued his sinful activity. There is nothing good whatsoever that we can say about it, because David was a polygamist. Now, I want to spend a few moments talking about polygamy today, not because, you know, I believe we have a lot of polygamists in the crowd today, but we need to kind of understand what's going on here. When we think about, first of all, his polygamy, there are three things about that I need to say that I believe I can make application. Number one was its prohibition. You see, there was no reason why David should have been a polygamist. Why? Because the Word of God had strictly taught against the practice of polygamy, and especially for those who were kings in Israel. For example, just make note of this verse, Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse number 17. The Bible is speaking here about the qualifications of the king, and it says, neither shall he multiply wives to himself, so that his heart turn not away. Neither shall he greatly multiply to himself silver or gold. So for the king, God said, listen, don't you take to yourself multiple wives, because if you do, they will turn your heart away from God. Now, friend, it doesn't matter what anybody says in the Mormon religion, polygamy is wrong. Polygamy has always been wrong. My goodness, God gave to Adam one wife. And that ought to tell us a little bit about how many wives God wants a man to have. Now, friend, listen, I'll guarantee you that there is no one here today who is a polygamist on paper. No one here that is married to multiple wives. And yet, did you know that there very well could be those in this service who are polygamist in their heart? And by the way, did you know that Jesus looks primarily not at the actions, but he looks at the heart? The Bible says man looks on the outward appearance, but God, he looks in the heart. And there's a New Testament verse that says that we ought to be a one woman man. And that applies to both men and women. Women ought to be a one whatever. She ought to be devoted to one man. Now what that simply means is that if we are married, that our allegiance, our emotions, our commitment ought to be to our wife and our wife alone. And if they are not, we are a polygamist in our hearts. Sir, let me ask you, are you flirtatious? Do you flirt with anything that walks around in a skirt? Then God very well says, you may be a polygamist. What about somebody that walks out on their spouse? They don't have any reason. They have no biblical grounds for leaving their wife or leaving their husband. They just leave them. And they go out and they marry somebody else. And they never repent of the sin they committed when they left their spouse. And they marry another person. And they think they're married to one, while God says, you're married to two. You're a polygamist. Polygamy, whether it's on paper or whether it's in the heart, it is not something that is of God. So it's prohibition. But secondly, we see its popularity. You realize that in Old Testament times, that polygamy was a popular thing. That in Old Testament days, there were many who had multiple wives. As a matter of fact, the godless culture of that day looked at a person's kingdom, and the more wives that person had, then the more blessed that person was. There were some of the great Bible heroes that were polygamist. I think about Jacob. I think about Gideon. I think about David's son Solomon. He was a polygamist. I wonder where Solomon learned that one from. As a matter of fact, Solomon, David's son, he got the champion award for polygamy. 700 wives, 300 concubines. 700 wives. Can you imagine the cat fights around his palace? 700 wives. Man, I've just got one. And that's all I think I'll say about that. But 700 wives. Now, Solomon, he may have written some wise proverbs, but I'll guarantee you, he didn't practice a lick of wisdom when it came to his family life. But here's the application I want to make for us today. It was popular in the culture, but it was not popular to God. Dear friend, when will we ever get the idea that, you know, we need to stop raising our families based on what the culture dictates as being right and wrong, and start raising our families based on what the Word of God dictates as being right and being wrong? Friend, listen, the culture may very well say that something's all right. The culture says that it's all right for men to marry men and women to marry women. God says, you be very careful. Paul has a good word of counsel here. He says, don't let the world squeeze you into its mold. Christian mothers and fathers, when it comes to raising our families today, we raise them according to God's design, not according to the way that the wind of cultural thought is blowing. And I want to speak to every mom and dad. I want you to listen with all of your heart. You realize that you are not responsible and I'm not responsible for the way that other parents raise their children. We're not responsible to God for that. But we are responsible to God for the way that we raise our children and what we allow our families to be involved in. And you see, if David would have done that, David would have not ended up experiencing the devastating consequences that he did. So polygamy, its prohibition, its popularity. Thirdly, its problems. When David made the decision, I'm going to raise my family and I'm not going to include God on that decision, there were serious problems. Do you realize the majority of the sons of David that came from these polygamous relationships turned out to be real losers? I mean, you think about some of them. There was Amnon. Amnon raped his half-sister Tamar. And then another son of David, Absalom, killed Amnon because Tamar was his whole sister. Then Adonijah sought to usurp the throne of his father. Now, friend, all of this tells us something serious. It tells us that when we try to raise our families not by God's design, we're going to produce a dysfunctional bunch. And there has never been a dysfunctional family more dysfunctional than the one that King David had. So it's prohibition, it's popularity, and it's problems. So it's polygamy. But secondly, it's passion. His passion. David was a passionate man. If you were to ask me today, Pastor, tell me what the greatest strength was in the life of David, I would answer quickly, his passion. Now you see, dear friend, now listen. That was as good as long as it was under the control of God. You know, you think about David. Whatever David did with all of his heart, didn't he? I mean, when he went out on the battlefield, he was a warrior and he fought with all of his heart. When he befriended somebody like Jonathan, he was a friend with all of his heart. But when those passions got out from underneath the control of God, his life consisted of rampant immorality. J. Oswald Sanders said, and I quote, that David's greatest fault was his yielding to the passions of the flesh. I think the lesson that we learn about passions is this. Our greatest strengths can become our greatest liabilities if they are not under the control of God. Whatever your greatest strength is, if it's not under God's control, can become your greatest liability. For example, here's a person, and this person is very bold. That's a good thing when it's under the control of God. Because a person goes out on Monday night on faith with great boldness and knocks on doors and tells people about the Lord Jesus Christ. But if that boldness is not under the control of God, then a person just becomes bold in their rebellion against God. And so the difference between a great strength and a great weakness is whether or not that is under the control of God. Friend, listen, whatever your strengths are that God has gifted you with, listen, you yield those things to the control of God, because if you do not, they will come back to haunt you every time. His passion. But then thirdly, his pursuit. His pursuit. You realize what happened to David? Because David was pursuing building his kingdom, he ended up losing his family. In the midst of all of the national blessings and the national success, he lost touch domestically. Have you ever wondered why it was that so many of David's children turned out to be real losers? Turn over with me to the right, to the next book, the book of 1 Kings. Let me show you something real quickly. 1 Kings chapter number 1, and let me show you a couple of verses here. 1 Kings chapter number 1, and I'm going to show you why it was the man after God's own heart that his children turned out to be duds and losers. 1 Kings chapter number 1. Remember, we're talking about his pursuit. He is pursuing building his kingdom. He is pursuing expanding its boundaries. He is pursuing his career and his success in life. And he was so involved in his pursuit until he didn't have any time to pay attention to his family. Look in 1 Kings chapter 1, verse number 5. Then Adonijah, that's the fourth son, the son of Haggith, exalted himself, saying, I will be king. And he prepared him chariots and horsemen, and 50 men to run before him. So this is his plan to overthrow his own father. Now look at verse 6. And his father had not displeased him at any time in saying, "Why hast thou done so?" His father has not displeased him. Let me translate that for you. His father had not confronted him. His father had not crossed him. One translation says his father had not pained him. How do you pain a child? By putting the belt to their bottom. But David never did that. David was so busy in building his own kingdom until he did not have time to pay attention to his family and discipline his children when they got out of line. And the result is they turned out to be real losers. Friend, I want to tell you what, I have never met a father in all of my ministry who said to me as they were approaching death, "Pastor, I would give anything if I could just go back and pay more attention to my career." But I have met tons of daddies who have said, "I wish I could go back and pay more attention to my family." Friend, I want to tell you, there is no pursuit in life that is more worthy than the pursuit of cultivating a godly family. What difference does it make, dads, if we have all the education in the world, so many degrees behind our name that we look like a thermometer? What difference does it make if we're financially independent by the time that we're 45? What difference does it make if we're smart in the stock market? What difference does it make if our children, under our tutelage, grow up not to be men and women of God? The most godly pursuit we could get after is the cultivation of a godly family. And how many parents lose that opportunity? In his autobiography, One Life, the brilliant surgeon who pioneered and performed the first heart transplant, a man by the name of Christian Bernard, tells how at the very height of his discoveries and his outstanding career that he lost his family. He writes, and I quote, "It was a brilliant, bright April morning when I drove out of Minneapolis heading for New York. It seemed a century had passed since I had first arrived, a time longer than all the years before it. In New York, I put the car on the boat and caught a plane for South Africa. At Cape Town, a northwest wind was blowing, and we came in over the sea with waves close below. My wife was there with the children. I had written little in the last 2 months, yet I was unprepared for her greeting. 'Why did you come back?' she said. 'Why didn't you stay in America and never come home again?' There was no longer a smile in her eyes, and her lips seemed to wait for nothing. 'Oh God,' I thought, 'I have made the worst and most terrible mistake of my life.' 'Don't look so surprised,' she said. 'We gave you up. We decided that you were never coming back.' 'It was only a little delay,' I said. 'I wrote you about it. We were building valves, aortic valves.' 'You also were building a family,' she said. 'I mean, once upon a time, you were building one until you dumped it all into my lap. We have ceased to exist for you.' I wanted to say that I came home because I loved my children and I believed I loved her, and I did it because I felt it. What could I say now that would not sound meaningless? It began to rain. The city was gray under a gray sky. It was winter in Cape Town and in Minneapolis. Spring was already there. How was it possible to lose a whole springtime?" David had lost a lot of springtimes. How many have you lost? How many have I lost? By not pursuing the single most important thing in life, building our family. And do you realize that this doesn't just apply to the men? It applies to the mamas too. Mama, let me tell you something. I am not old-fashioned. I just believe the book. And for every mother, you listen to me. Your most important place in life is not your career. It is your family. God says, you, mama, you are the homemaker. Now, I know so many of you have to work, and that's not what I'm talking about. And there are some who sacrifice having other things to stay at home to raise those children. And I applaud you for that. God bless you for that. But there's some mothers that they can't take care of their children and their husbands because they're running all over the place getting spiritual. They got to be at a Bible study on Monday night and this on Tuesday night and church on Wednesday night and something else spiritual on Thursday night. When mama, you need to take a break from that and stay at home and build a godly family. Now, don't shout me down on that one. David lost his family because of his pursuit of so many other things. There's one last lesson, and I close. A lesson of success, a lesson of family, and then last of all, a lesson of sin. A lesson of sin. If you listen here, say amen. Amen. There are two lessons that we learn here about sin. First of all, we learn a lesson about culmination. Culmination. Did you realize that gross sin is the result, the culmination of a process? Never as the result of a single act. It is always the culmination of a process. No one who ever commits gross sin does so on the spur of the moment. It is always the culmination of a process. We learned that from David. The process began back in chapter number 3 when he was marrying all these women and he was amassing great fortune. And he wasn't satisfied. He had to have more. So he got in chapter 5, got more fortune and more wives and more concubines. And it ended up in terrible disaster. I have talked to so many people who have said on the morning after a great sin, I can't believe that I did that. And I always say to them, a year earlier, you wouldn't have done that. But there was a process that developed over a period of time, and the result was this tragic thing that has happened. Friend, I want to tell you, if you are in the middle of a process today, if you are wise enough to stop the process, you will not experience the culmination. But if you continue in the process, it's going to be lights out. And so we learn a lesson about the culmination of sin. And then last of all, we learn a lesson about the consequences of sin. I go back to what I said in our introduction, how that today we just kind of blow off mistakes. Don't worry about them. They even had people tell me, but Pastor, the grace of God will forgive me. And that's exactly right. But friend, I want to tell you, confession and repentance will help heal the wound, but it will never erase all the scars. Won't do it. David lived with the scars of his polygamous life until the day that he died. And I think sometimes that God allows the scars to stay to remind us of the consequences of a rebellious heart against him. David died a forgiven man. But you know what haunts me? He died a scarred man. His scars were not taken away. The blood of Jesus does not wash away the scars. It heals the wound. We have forgiveness. Grace is extended. Our salvation certainly is not taken away. Our fellowship is restored with God. But friend, the scars remain. And I don't know about you, but I want to die as unscarred as I possibly can. Don't you? Don't you want to die that way? When I was growing up, I used to race motocross bikes. And if you took a dirt bike and you hooked it up with Craig Connor, there was a potential disaster that was going to happen. Some buddies and myself, we were out riding one day at an old dirt pit. And they had just dug a big hole. They were hauling the dirt off somewhere, and they left this huge mound. And so my buds and I, we were talking about jumping that hill. And everybody agreed that it was a mistake to try it. Everybody but me. And I said, man, I can handle it. And so I got a running start with that enduro bike of mine. I hit the bottom of that hill. And man, you would have thought the rapture was happening. I was heading straight up. And I was fine as long as I was in the air. But when I came down and touched terra firma, I somehow lost control of that bike. And that wasn't the worst part. It would have been all right if it would have all ended right there. But when I landed, somehow that big old 250, Yamaha 250, landed on top of me. And it was so heavy, I couldn't get out from underneath it. And so I'm lying there, and the muffler is on my leg. And it's just sizzling, cooking away. The thing got infected later, and I mean, it was real trouble. Now, I got over the mistake. I lived. God in His grace didn't kill me like He should have. I lived. But you know what? I live to tell you that I paid for that mistake. Because today I live with the scars. Got a huge scar all across this leg from that muffler burning me. Now, friend, listen. Are you making some spiritual mistakes and you know it? Stop it. And the worst mistake anyone could ever make is to say no to Jesus Christ. Because those consequences are eternal. Eternal. If we make mistakes as God's kids, listen, they're not eternal, those scars. But the scar of an unbeliever will be eternal. Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed. And God, how I pray that we would take seriously, that we would think soberly about the mistakes that we make, that we do not have to make, that are simply in direct correlation to a rebellious spirit against the word and the will of God. And I pray, God, that if there are those here today, and I really sense in my heart there are, who are in a process that is leading them to a devastating act, I pray today in Jesus' name they would stop it. I pray, Lord, for those who are here today and they've made the mistake of rejecting You, that today they would stop making that mistake. They would come forward and tell one of our ministers that they want to be saved today. I pray, God, for those You've spoken to their hearts about uniting with our church family, I pray, God, that they would come. For those who need to utilize this altar just to get along with You, I pray today that they would come as well. And oh God, how I pray that we would line our hearts and our thinking up with the Word of God today. And we would be serious about what the Spirit has spoken to our hearts about. And we would simply do it. In Jesus' name I pray. Our heads are bowed and eyes closed, choir singing. We invite you to come.